Deuteros, meaning two or second, and nomos being the Greek word for law. So the second giving of the law, the second stating of the law, and we're going to see that. Let's pray, and then we're going to get into Deuteronomy. Dear Holy Father, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we bow before you tonight in Jesus' name, grateful because we have a Savior who is truly altogether lovely, altogether worthy. And we're grateful that wherever we turn in your holy book, our Bible, that we can see portraits of him, glimpses of him, anticipations of him. We're reminded as we go through the Old Testament and studying the seeing Jesus in all of Scripture that is the only, these 39 books are the only documents that the early believers had to preach Jesus from. And they did so very effectively. So help us tonight to see Jesus, to understand the flow of Deuteronomy, its place in the canon, and leave here more enraptured with our Savior than perhaps when we came. But we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Turn in your Bibles, please, to Deuteronomy chapter 30, verses 19 to 20, which is just a brief passage we're going to read to set the stage, set the context for our discussion tonight, our looking through this summary of Deuteronomy. Stand with me if you would, and as you're standing, I'm going to read also, in addition, before I read the passage itself, I want to read the theme passage. We cite it for you. I just want to read it. It's John chapter 5, verses 39 to 40. Jesus said to the religious leaders, "You search the Scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life. And it is they that bear witness about me, yet you refuse to come to me that you may have life." Now Deuteronomy 30, 19 and 20. Moses, toward the end of his life, says, "I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I've set before you life and death, blessing and curse. Therefore choose life that you and your offspring may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying his voice, and holding fast to him. For it is your life and length of days that you may dwell in the land that the Lord swore to your fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, to give them." This is the inerrant, infallible, all-sufficient Word of God. May we see the significance and power of this book. Something that someone has called Moses' Upper Desert Discourse, and then see Jesus in the midst of all of it. Thank you. Be seated. Well, as every book we've looked at so far, we've given you sort of a summary description. The key idea in Deuteronomy is the renewed covenant. Remember now, think about this. When they came out of Egypt and gathered around Mount Sinai, and the Ten Commandments were given to them there, this generation, 40 years later, was not, most of them not on the scene, and those who were would not have been of sufficient age to really grip and embrace what was being given. So this is a second giving. This is the giving of the law to this new generation that's about to cross over. So the renewed covenant, the nation here is made ready to cross over. The people are retaught. God's character shown here is that of a loving Lord. To reward those who obey him, who honor him. And then the command here is obey. Obey. Moses is at the end of his life. Joshua has been appointed as his successor. Moses reminds this generation that grew up in the wilderness. Remember, most of these never knew the bondage of Egypt. He reminds them of God's dealings in the past. He reviews with them the need, the importance for righteousness and integrity in the present. and he reveals what's going to happen in the near and distant future. It's really interesting. Toward the end of the book, Moses says, I know that you will rebel against the Lord, and he'll carry you off into captivity. It's a very tragic promise and warning that comes. But then he blesses the people, and he views the promised land from Mount Nebo before his death. As I said, one writer that I read on this was called this Moses' Upper Desert Discourse. And you understand the play there. It's a playoff of Jesus' Upper Room Discourse in John's Gospel, where he's giving final words. So they call it the Upper Desert Discourse. It's a series of farewell messages by Moses, who's 120 years old at this point in his life, addressed to those who are about to possess the land of promise, to those who survived the 40 years of wilderness wandering. And again, Norman and I were talking this morning, if you've been reading through the scriptures, the Numbers, just multitudes were killed in God's response to their disobedience as they journeyed in the wilderness. Leviticus, we studied a couple weeks ago, contains a lot of legal detail. Particularly to the priests and their function in the sacrifices. Deuteronomy, though, emphasizes the importance of those who are not of the priestly tribe, the common man, that if they're to learn from the example of their forefathers, then they will be committed to obedience. So they've moved from history to the call to holiness, to looking forward to the future, and God, Moses stresses God's faithfulness to them. It's interesting, we looked at that this morning in Corinthians, and it's stressed again here in Deuteronomy. He brought us out. Deuteronomy 6:23 says, he brought us out from there, out of Egypt, that he might bring us in and give us the land that he swore to give to our fathers. This is the working out of the promise made to Abraham. I want us to watch now a brief video, which is a summary of the book of Deuteronomy.
The book of Deuteronomy is the fifth book of the Bible and the final book of the Torah. After the Exodus from Egypt, Israel was at Mount Sinai for 1 year, entering into a covenant with their God. And then they had the disastrous road trip through the wilderness, and the Exodus generation disqualified themselves from entering into the land promised to Abraham. And so Deuteronomy begins with Moses standing in front of this new generation explaining the Torah. And it's from here that the design and purpose of the book unfolds. Deuteronomy is a series of speeches from Moses where he's calling the next generation of Israel to be faithful to the covenant with their God. At the center of the book is a collection of laws, which are the terms of the covenant between God and Israel. Some of the laws are new, but many are repeated from the laws given earlier at Mount Sinai. And that's actually where this book gets its name, from a Greek word, Deuteronomion, which means a second law. Now, surrounding these laws are two outer sections of Moses' speech. Each of these are broken up into two parts themselves. Let's just dive in and we'll see how this whole thing works. So Moses, first of all, summarizes the story so far, and he highlights how rebellious the previous generation was, in contrast with God's constant grace and provision in the wilderness. And God did bring his justice on them, yes, but he did not abandon his covenant promises. After this comes a series of very passionate sermons where Moses calls on this new generation to be more faithful than their parents were to the covenant. He reminds them of the Ten Commandments, and then the centerpiece of this section is a famous line called the Shema. Moses says, "Listen, Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone, and you shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your might." This became a very important daily prayer in Judaism, and it brings all of the themes of the book together. So the word listen, or shema in Hebrew, it means much more than just to hear. Its meaning includes responding to what you hear, or in English we would say obey. And the word love in Hebrew also means much more than just an emotion or feeling. It's about a decision of wholehearted devotion to God that involves your will and your emotions, your mind and your heart. Now, for Israel, their obedience and devotion to God served a much larger purpose. Obedience to the laws is going to make Israel a unique people among the nations. Just like God said at Mount Sinai, they will become a kingdom of priests. And Moses now says, how? Israel has the chance, by following the laws, to show the whole world the wisdom and the justice of God. The other key idea in the Shema is that Israel was called to obey and be devoted to the Lord alone. Or literally, in Hebrew, it says, the Lord is one. Now, in context, the point is that the Lord is the one God Israel is to worship and obey. Israel's about to go into the land of Canaan, where people worship idol gods that represent all different aspects of creation, the sun, the weather, sex, and war. And in Moses' view, worshiping these gods degrades humans and destroys communities. But worshiping the God of Israel, who's the creator and the redeemer, that will lead to life and blessing. And so we come to the large collection of laws at the center of the book. And they're roughly arranged by topic. So the opening section is about Israel's worship of their God. They were to have one central temple where one God would be worshiped. And also, God was to be worshiped in Israel's care for its poor. So for example, all Israelites were to set aside 1/10 of their annual income to be given to the temple. But another 1/10 was to be set aside every 3 years and given to the poor. And these are the kinds of laws that put Israel on the cutting edge of justice in comparison to their ancient neighbors. And it was all bound up with their worship of God. The next section outlines the character qualities of Israel's leaders. So the elders, the priests, the kings, these were all placed under the authority of the covenant laws, which God said that he would enforce by sending prophets to keep the leaders accountable. So in contrast to Israel's neighbors, where kings were thought of as divine and a law unto themselves, Israel's leaders were subordinate to the law and the prophets. Following this is a large section of laws about Israel's civil life, so rules about marriage and family and business, and also about social justice, about their legal system and how it was to protect widows and orphans and immigrants. And then these are concluded by more laws about worship. Now, here's some tips for reading all of these laws. Remember, first of all, these are the terms of the Sinai covenant given specifically to ancient Israel, living in a culture that's very different from yours. And so, two, it's not going to be helpful to compare these laws with modern laws from a very different culture. Rather, these were given to set Israel apart. And so we need to compare these laws with those of Israel's neighbors, like in Assyria or Babylon. And when you do that, all of a sudden, laws that seemed harsh or bizarre become much more clear. You see that God is pushing Israel to a higher level of justice than was ever known before. And so finally, try to discern what core principles of wisdom or justice underlie any particular law, and you'll discover some really profound things. So here's an extra credit assignment. Go see how Paul the Apostle does this very thing in his first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 9, verse 9, and he quotes a law from Deuteronomy, chapter 25, verse 4. It's really interesting. So back to Moses. After he goes through all of the laws, he issues a final challenge that Israel should listen to and love their God. He first issues a warning and an ultimatum. If Israel listens to and obeys their God, everything's going to go great, lots of divine blessing. But if they don't listen and rebel, famine, plague, devastation, and ultimately exile from the land. And then Moses forces a decision. He says, "Today I set before you all life or death, blessing or curse, goodness or evil, so choose life by loving the Lord your God and listening to him." But then Moses says this. He says, "I know that after I die, you're going to rebel and turn away from God and end up in exile," which is kind of a downer. But then again, he's been with these people for decades, and it becomes clear that his hopes are not very high. "But all is not lost," Moses says. "One day, when Israel is sitting in exile, at any point," Moses says, "they can turn back to their God, who will," in his words, "circumcise your hearts so that you may love him with all your heart and soul and live." Now, this is a vivid metaphor that's saying something is fundamentally wrong with Israel's heart. It's stubborn and hard. And it's the same thing wrong with the heart of all of humanity. This is going all the way back to the rebellion in the garden. Humans seized autonomy from God. They wanted to define good and evil for themselves, and they ruined God's good world as a result. But one day, Moses says, God is going to do something to transform the hearts of his people so that they can truly listen to and love God from the heart and be led back to true life. And this is the promise that gets picked up by the later biblical prophets, Jeremiah and Ezekiel, the hope for a new heart. So Moses ends his speech with a poem of warning and then of blessing, and then he walks up onto a mountain and he dies. And so the Torah draws to a close. All of the major plot tensions of the biblical story are in place, but left totally unresolved. So when is the descendant of the woman going to come and defeat evil? Or how is God going to rescue the whole world and bless all nations through this family? And how can God's holiness be reconciled with people who are continually rebellious? And how is God going to transform the hearts of his people? You just have to keep reading to find out. But for now, that's what the book of Deuteronomy is all about.
Okay, that's a good little summary of the book. I want to just real quickly show you what he's talking about. Turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 9. I've said to you before, and I hope that things are clearing up as you see these graphics particularly, that when God gave the law, gave the Ten Commandments, that was moral law. It continues to shape and influence. There was ceremonial law, and you see that all in the book of Leviticus, and you'll pick up some more of it here, Deuteronomy, that was designed to hedge Israel in and keep them relatively pure, ethnically speaking, that they might be a people through whom Messiah would come. And then there was civil and judicial law. Again, it was the same thing. And he makes a great point here that if you read some of the laws in the Old Testament, you think, gosh, that seems so harsh. But you need to compare them to other laws that preceded them. Hammurabi Code was one that was mentioned there. And just see the severity of how that culture dealt with. And even today, to this day, if you go into certain Middle Eastern countries and someone is caught stealing in the marketplace, justice is swift. Right there, on the spot, the authorities will take that person, lay his arm out, and cut his hand off. Swift public justice, very severe, very severe. So there's still, in places of the world, particularly where Islam holds forth, where this kind of ancient swift justice that preceded or was around the same time as the law being given was prevailing, and God comes with his law and it's very compassionate by comparison. And so as you see the books of the Bible unfold, and as we move closer and closer to the coming of Jesus Christ, you're going to become keenly aware that God, that the ceremonial law will fall by the wayside when Jesus Christ comes on the scene. The civil law will fall by the wayside and the moral law will continue. And so with that in mind, look at 1 Corinthians 9, verse 9. Now, Paul is arguing here about one having the right to reap where he has sown. In fact, you might want to just back up real quickly. Verse 6, is it only Barnabas and I who have no right to refrain from working for a living? Who serves as a soldier at his own expense? Who plants a vineyard without eating any of its fruit? Who tends a flock without getting some of the milk? Now, what he's talking about here basically is remuneration of gospel ministers. And then notice what he says. Do I say these things on human authority? Does not the law say the same? And here he's citing the passage in Deuteronomy. For it's written in the law of Moses, you shall not muzzle an ox when it treads out the grain. Now watch how Paul makes a moral application. This is what's important to learn about the law. That even though some of the civil laws and the ceremonial laws may have fallen by the wayside, there are still moral applications that obtain out of them. And it's really one of the keys to reading the Old Testament accurately and not getting caught in the weeds of, well, should I, I'm going to have goat tonight. I'm not supposed to cook a goat, a baby goat in its mother's milk. That's all dealing with the specifics and the expressions of ceremonial law and civil law. What you need to do is learn to look at the principle that comes out of that. And this is what Paul's doing here. He says, is it for oxen that God is concerned? In other words, when God said that in Deuteronomy, was the end of the matter that God's an animal lover and he wants to be sure that you don't mistreat your oxen? Well, that's certainly was in play here, but Paul makes the observation of the Holy Spirit that there's moral application that obtains even in a day when you don't own oxen. And the principle is that the laborer is worthy of his hire. That's the principle that comes out of that. Just to share that briefly so you see that all these laws, you can get caught up in them until you learn. Let me read the laws with gospel lenses, with moral implications, and you learn a lot. It instructs you a lot about how to live. And I want to go now into just real touch on some things. If you look at how Deuteronomy is divided, and he showed us that there's these three primary times of sermons that Moses speaks, and he talks about. The first sermon is about what God has done. Okay, so it's a historical survey. Covers chapter 1, verse 1 through chapter 4, verse 43. He's reviewing God's acts on behalf of Israel. He reminds them of two things: the moral judgment of God upon Israel's unbelief, and the deliverance and provision of God during times of obedience. The bottom line: obedience brings blessing, disobedience brings punishment. And that's still generally true. It's a principle of life today. I mean, the fifth commandment, honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long upon the land which the Lord your God has given you, is a principle. It's a moral principle, a moral commandment, that talks about that, in generally speaking, we know many people whose lives have come to a tragic end because they did not follow the instruction of their mother or their father. Then the second sermon, which covers chapter 4, verse 44 through chapter 26, verse 19, and is broken into these divisions of law, is what God expects. So the first one is the fact, what God has done. And in the way he has done it, you should see that obedience brings blessing, disobedience brings curse or judgment. So in this second sermon, he does an exposition of the Ten Commandments, first of all, chapter 4, verse 44 through 11, 32. And it's in this setting that you have the Shema. And he mentioned that, chapter 6 of Deuteronomy. And this was the one, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your strength, with all your soul, with all your might. And this shall be bound upon you. If you read that section, it's very fascinating. You're to wear this as frontlets between your eyes. Bind it upon your wrists, over the doorpost of your house. And while they did that literally, the picture there is that this is to obtain with you. This is how you learn to live what God expects. He goes on to say, you shall teach these things to your children when you rise up, when you walk in the way, and when you lie down. It's if you know people who have homeschooled their children, Karen and I did that. It was one of the guiding principles that we used, that from the time they get up in the morning to the time they go to bed at night, we need to be teaching them that the Lord our God is one God. He is the only God, the true and living God. And so the Jews were to embrace this and follow this. And of course, their understanding would be tied up, summarily comprehended, remember, in the Ten Commandments. We looked at that when we looked at Exodus 20. I won't rehearse all that tonight, but this is what he's teaching the generation that's about to go over, that your life will be shaped by God's law. It's interesting, my friend Fred Malone, I think he's the first one I ever heard say, he said, Jesus Christ is the law walking. Perfect obedience to the law of God. He said, in fact, he said, one way you can see the gospel is just that God, the law giver, sent Jesus Christ, the law keeper, to die for law breakers. It's a great way to think about it when you're thinking from an Old Testament picture of that. So this second sermon, though, covers ceremonial laws, civil laws, social laws. The civil and social laws are all a part of this whole judicial system of how you relate. You'll remember the laws of threshing, perhaps, that they would practice later on. That when you go to harvest your fields, you're to harvest in such a way that you leave in the corners of your field grain that could be gathered, and the poor were allowed to come in and gather that. It's a part of the whole caring for the poor, that you don't only look to your own needs, but the needs of others, and you show kindness to the poor, kindness to the stranger. This was totally revolutionary in the day that a people would be given revelation law. Totally, totally turned it on its head. These testimonies, as I said, are in chapter 5, verse 11, the statutes, chapter 12 to 16, the ordinances, chapter 16 to the end of that, to chapter 26. And then the third sermon. So you have what God has done, the first one, what God expects, the second one. Now, what God will do. If the first one was historical, the second one is legal, the third one is prophetic. Here's what you can expect. He's going to ratify the covenant, 27:1 to 28:68. He's going to make the what's called the Palestinian covenant with them in the land of Palestine, 29:1 to 30:20. And then he's going to show them the transition of who the covenant mediator will be. That Moses will not take them in, but Joshua, Moses' successor, will. So here, one writer said, Moses is writing history in advance. He predicts what's going to come to them in terms of the blessings and cursings, and even ultimately in the dispersions among the nations and their eventual return. And since he's not going to be allowed to go in, and we told you about that last week, though he struck the rock when he was commanded to speak to the rock, he appoints Joshua as his successor. He delivers this very touching farewell address to the congregation. And then as Moses ascends into the mount, God is the one who takes care of Moses' burial in the face of his death in an unknown place. And then I want you to look at Matthew 17:3. I mentioned this to you a couple weeks ago. In Matthew 17:3, on the Mount of Transfiguration, a mountain that, by the way, is in what you and I would recognize to be the Promised Land, behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. And so even after his death, God mercifully allows Moses to stand on the Mount of Transfiguration inside the land called the Promised Land. If you want an epitaph for the life of Moses, listen to this in Deuteronomy 34, 10 to 12. These are the closing verses of the book. There has not arisen a prophet since in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face, none like him for all the signs and the wonders that the Lord sent him to do in the land of Egypt, to Pharaoh, to all his servants and to all his land, and for all the mighty power and all the great deeds of terror that Moses did in the sight of all Israel. It would remind you what we're talking about this morning. Isn't it wonderful that God does not require perfection for those whom he will use? Moses had his flaws, some major flaws. Moses had a past. He had a history. And yet, the commendation that God gives to Moses through Joshua, as this book closes, is very fitting and very touching. And then if you want to get a context here, what we read in Deuteronomy takes place in the course of about 1 month on the plains of Moab. We looked at that last week. They're camped and ready to go across Jordan. Joshua will take them across Jordan into the Promised Land in a very similar, when we see this, very similar fashion as Moses led the people out of Egypt across the Red Sea. Joshua will lead the people into the Promised Land across the Jordan River in a very similar way. It should remind them of God's protection and his provision. When you look at the name itself, Deuteronomy, in the Hebrew, it literally means, it's the words, and it's taken from, as typically you found by now, the opening phrase in chapter 1, verse 1, these are the words. And so Deuteronomy in the Hebrew is the words, parting words of Moses to another generation. The Jewish people have also called Deuteronomy the Mishnah HaTorah, in other words, the repetition of the law. We mentioned that the Septuagint, the Greek version of the Old Testament, is Deuteronomian Tauto, the second law. So it kind of gives you a little background of the flavor of the names. Mosaic authorship. I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time on this. I want to touch these real quickly, not because we've already established that Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, clearly are authored by Moses. You have to just reject the authority of the text to come up in a different way. Well, let's just look real quickly. Just going to blow through these verses for you so you can see them. People, by the way, you need to know this. Of all the books of the law, Deuteronomy has been attacked most seriously because Moses dies at the end of it. So people want, well, no, this was written, they want to actually position it rather than 1405, position it like in the 6th century, centuries after this. Just real quickly, Joshua 1:7. Joshua saying, only be strong and very courageous. Be careful to do according to all the law that Moses, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or to the left, that you may have good success wherever you go. That's Joshua. Judges 3:4. They were for the testing of Israel, to know whether Israel would obey the commandments of the Lord, which he commanded their fathers by the hand of Moses. You'll find something similar in 1 Kings 2:3. Walking in the ways as it's written in the law of Moses. 2 Kings 14:6. Notice to what is written in the book of the law of Moses, where the Lord commanded fathers shall not be put to death because of their children nor children. So it's citing Deuteronomic law. Ezra, same thing. Nehemiah 1:7. We've acted very corruptly, the people, when they're repenting, they're returning from captivity against you and have not kept the commandments, the statutes, and the rules that you commanded your servant Moses. Psalm 103. These are just samplings of many, many references to this. He made known his ways to Moses, his acts to the people of Israel. Daniel 9:11. Again, the penitent plea. All Israel's transgressed your law and turned aside, refusing to obey your voice. And the curse and oath that are written in the law of Moses, the servant of God, have been poured out upon us. Then Malachi, the last book in the Old Testament, 4:4. Remember the law of my servant Moses, the statutes and rules that I commanded him at Horeb for all of Israel. That's external Old Testament evidence. New Testament, real quickly. Christ quotes Deuteronomy as God's word. And just touch these. Matthew 4:4, 7, and 10. Jesus answered, it's written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. Then in verse 7, Jesus said again, it's written, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test. He's quoting Deuteronomy here. Jesus said to him, begone, Satan, for it's written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. So he is citing what we know to be in the book of Deuteronomy as the word of God, authentic by Moses. And then he attributes these things directly to Moses. Matthew 19:7-9, where he's talking about divorce and remarriage. He said, why did Moses command one to give a certificate of divorce and to send her away? See, he's citing Mosaic authorship. Mark 7:10, Moses said, honor your father and your mother, and whoever reviles father or mother must surely die. That's in Deuteronomy. Luke 20:28. He said, teacher, Moses wrote that for us that if a man's brother dies, having no wife, take up a widow. So they're saying to him this, and then John 5:45-47. Do not think that I will accuse you to the Father. There is no one accusing you. Moses, on whom you have set your hope. For if you believe Moses, you would believe me. And he's just identifying Moses as the author of God's word. And then in Acts, a couple more just real quickly. Acts 3:22, Moses said, the Lord God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your brothers. You shall listen to him and whatever he tells you. Moses prophesied this, and it was a messianic prophecy of Jesus, a prophet just like me. And then Romans 10:19, but I ask, did Israel not understand? For first Moses says, I will make you jealous of those who are not a nation. So we have these citations, Old Testament and New Testament. And then there's within the book itself, and we're not going to, I'm just going to cite the passages, and you can dig these out on your own. Deuteronomy 31:24-26, when he finished writing the book, this law in the book to the very end, then he says, take this book of the law and put it by the side of the Ark of the Covenant. Deuteronomy 1:1-5, I want you to read that. Deuteronomy 4:44-46, jot that one down too, the same thing. This is within the book of Deuteronomy itself, citing Mosaic authorship. And then Deuteronomy 29:1, these are the words of the covenant that the Lord commanded Moses to make with the people of Israel in the land of Moab, besides the covenant that he had made with them at Horeb. And then 31:9, Moses wrote this law and gave it to the priests, the sons of Levi, who carried the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord to all the elders of Israel. So we see this witness, and there's other external geographical considerations that the language of it fits the kind of treaty language that would have used in the 15th and 14th century BCs, which is when we find the writing of this. Look over at, jump over a couple of verses here. Look at Joshua chapter 1, verse 2. God speaks to Joshua, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now therefore arise, go over this Jordan, you and all this people, into the land that I'm giving to them, to the people of Israel. And so we place that traveling over into Jordan. It gives us about that 1405 B.C. time frame that we've been telling you about since we began to build the chronology here. One of the themes is beware lest you forget. And that was very critical. This is a generation that, again, was primarily, by and large, born in the wilderness, not born in captivity, born in the wilderness. So they would not necessarily have remembered the horrors of Egypt. And some of them would not remember all the trials. And so there's this warning, don't forget. This is why, by the way, when you see over and over in the Old Testament, they're constantly reciting the mighty works of God, the blessings of God, the judgments of God upon the people, as a constant warning lest the people go down that path again. So they're called upon to remember when they prosper, it is God who has caused it, and when they disobey God, he will discipline them as he did with the previous generation that failed to believe him at Kadesh Barnea. It's a call to obedience as a condition to blessing. Now we know that under the gospel that changes somewhat, but there's still the call to obedience. Very interesting. When you get over in the New Testament, there's one word for obey. We talked to you about this before when it's come up in the New Testament. That literally means to hear under. So when you go back to the Shema, Deuteronomy 6:4, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. It is not, as was cited in the little video we saw, not just to take in, to be aware, to hear something. It's hear with a view to doing, to obeying. The gospel comes along and says trust and obey, because in the gospel you understand that without faith it is impossible to please him. That an attempt at obedience outside the gospel is going to fail. And this is what you see in the life of most of Israel. You have those exceptions. Hebrews chapter 11 gives us this hall of fame of the faithful who lived throughout the Old Testament. But by and large, the people grew up with a sort of a pedantic, just, I'm going to try, I'm going to try, I'm going to try. In fact, there was one of the Puritans had this little couplet they used. Do this and live, the law commands. But gives us neither feet nor hands. A sweeter sound the gospel brings. It bids us fly and gives us wings. So all of this in the Old Testament, these commands of God, the promise of blessing in the face of obedience, the warning of judgment in the face of disobedience, is designed to hedge these people in and to teach them once and for all, we cannot do this on our own. We need a mediator. Just a real quick word about the treaties. You have this preamble. It's a list of the parties that are making a treaty. This is following what's called the suzerainty treaties of the people around them in the Old Testament era. There's a historical prologue, the blessings of the kings in times past, and then the stipulations. And then the ratification, which is the blessings and cursings in chapter 27 to 30. Just look Real quickly, Deuteronomy 30, 19 and 20. We've already read it. We read it to open up our time tonight, but I want you to see it now. This is the language of the ratification of the covenant, the second giving of the law. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessing and curse. See the picture there? Obey and live. Obey, receive blessing. Disobey, death. And they'd seen plenty of that in the wilderness journey. Disobey, curses. One of the ultimate curses is the dissolution of them scattered by captivity, which would happen in 722 and then again in 586 B.C. They're told to hear. Think about this. 50 times in the book of Deuteronomy, the call to hear, to listen. Remember Jesus' famous line, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear." It's a theme that's, and it's always with a view to doing. Listen in order to do. 50 times to hear. Do, keep, observe 177 times in Deuteronomy. And then they're called to do this out of a heart of love 21 times, which is the key to moving this to where it needs to go. If there's a key word in Deuteronomy, it's the word covenant. The key verses, I'll read one that we haven't read yet, and the other you'll be familiar with. Deuteronomy 10, 12 to 13, "And now, Israel, what does the Lord your God require of you?" When you read that, you think what immediately? Micah 6, 8, the prophecy of Micah. What does the Lord require of you but to fear the Lord your God, to walk in all his ways, to love him, to serve the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and to keep the commandments and statutes of the Lord, which I'm commanding you today for your good. This is what the Lord requires of you. So this is a key passage where they're being called, the new generation called to what the older generation was called to as they were coming out of Egypt and gathering around Mount Sinai. Then Deuteronomy 30, 19, and 20. We won't read that again. I've read it twice already, but it's that other thing. I've set before you life or death. The key chapter is probably chapter 27, where there's that formal ratification of the covenant. Where's the one of those, take heed and listen, verse 9 of chapter 27. Take heed and listen, O Israel. This day you have become the people of the Lord your God. In other words, you've this generation now has entered into the covenant, and you are God's people as he's about to take you over. What about Jesus? Look at chapter 18, verse 15. The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your midst for your brethren. You shall hear him. And just to keep on reading that in verse 16, just as you desired of the Lord your God at Horeb on the day of the assembly, when you said, "Let me not hear again the voice of the Lord my God or see this great fire anymore, lest I die." And the Lord said to me, "They are right in what they've spoken. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brothers. And I'll put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak to them in all that I command him. And whoever will not listen to my words that he shall speak in my name, I myself will require it of him." And then you see this Acts 7:37. This is the Moses who said to the Israelites, "God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your brothers." What you see in Deuteronomy is what the old writers and some of the catechisms called the offices of Jesus Christ. If you ask the children, what offices did Christ undertake in the covenant of grace? The office of prophet, of priest, and of king. And if you ask the children, well, why do you need a prophet? What does Christ do for you in the office of a prophet? He teaches me the will of God. Why do you need a prophet? Because I'm ignorant. I need to learn. What does he do for you in the office of priest? He prays to God for me and offers sacrifice unto God. Why do you need a priest? Because I'm sinful. What does he do in the office of king? He rules over me and defends me. Why do you need a king? Because I'm weak and helpless. The Catechism teaches these children the offices of Jesus Christ. And what's critical about that is that I would submit to you that not many people who teach the Scripture understand the offices of Jesus Christ. They're critical. And you see them here in Deuteronomy. Look real quickly. As a prophet in chapter 34, verse 10 to 12, there's not arisen a prophet since Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face, none like him for all the signs. And of course, it's anticipating, as we read earlier, it's not only an epitaph for Moses, it's anticipating another prophet that will rise up. He functions as a priest in the law. Exodus 32, 31 to 35. The people have sinned a great sin. They've made for themselves gods of gold. But now if you'll forgive their sin, notice Moses' role. We looked at this in Exodus where he intercedes for them. He pleads with God on their behalf. And that's what Jesus does. And so you see in the Mosaic figure the foreshadowing of Jesus Christ, prophet, priest, and king. And then Deuteronomy 33, 4 to 5. It's interesting because you never see Moses take upon the name king to himself, nor do you see the people giving it to him. But he functions, when you think about these 2 to 3 million people that he's leading around the desert for 40 years, he's functioning in a rulership role as a king over them. Look at this. Moses commanded us a law as a possession for the assembly of Jacob. The Lord became king in Jeshurun when the heads of the people were gathered, all the tribes of Israel. So Moses represents the God to these people in this way. The contribution, Jesus Christ as prophet, priest, and king. And this comes out in Deuteronomy and in the law of God. And those you see Jesus Christ. I said earlier, my friend Fred Malone says, Jesus Christ is the law walking. The more, think about this, the more you learn the Ten Commandments evangelically, in other words, from a gospel perspective, the more you see the beauty and person of Jesus Christ. The more you understand when we say he kept the whole law for his people. You see that in the Ten Commandments summarized, as the moral law summarized. As the law walking, the more you understand the Ten Commandments, the more you appreciate the depth and the breadth of the sacrifice of Jesus on our behalf. He dies because we are lawbreakers. He keeps the law. He dies for lawbreakers. So Deuteronomy wraps up the Torah. It's a supplementary book to the rest of the Pentateuch, the five books of the law. It fills a role, one author said, I thought this was good, similar to that of the Gospel of John compared to the Synoptic Gospel. And we talked about that before. The Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, the word synoptic simply means seen together. You take Matthew, Mark, and Luke, if you could put them in a three-column document, even in the English, you will find entire sections that are almost verbatim, identical, covering many chronological issues the same. John comes along, though, in an interpretive way. And just like the Gospel of John fills in the missing elements and gives spiritual significance, so Deuteronomy does the same. Gives spiritual significance to the other books of Moses. Genesis to Numbers portrays God's way. Deuteronomy reveals God's love. One fellow had this list, which I thought was good. In Genesis to Numbers, we have the development of Israel's history. In Deuteronomy, we have the philosophy of Israel's history. Genesis to Numbers, we have the divine performances of God. Deuteronomy, we have the divine principles. Genesis to Numbers, God speaks to Moses. Deuteronomy, Moses speaks to the people in this array of sermons that we've talked about. You may not recognize this, but one of the emphases of Deuteronomy is the love of God. Them understand that this God, this creator, this redeemer who brought them out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage, and led them in the wilderness to the Mount Sinai where the law was given and then given again as they get ready to cross over, that this God, he does all of this because he loves them. Look at this. Deuteronomy 4:37. Because he loved your fathers and chose their offspring after them and brought you out of Egypt with his own presence by his great power. Look at Deuteronomy 7:7-8. It was not because you were more in number. We read this morning in our responsive reading. Other people, then the Lord set his love on you and chose you, for you were the fewest of the peoples. Because the Lord loves you and is keeping the oath that he swore to his father, to your fathers, that the Lord has brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you from the house of slavery, from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. And then Deuteronomy 10:15, yet the Lord set his heart in love on your fathers and chose their offspring after them, you above all peoples, as you are this day. In Deuteronomy 23:5, but the Lord your God would not listen to Balaam. Instead, the Lord your God turned the curse into a blessing for you because the Lord your God loved you. Someone has said that, and I'll close with this, that Deuteronomy was perhaps Jesus Christ's favorite book. He quoted from it very often. We've already cited to you Matthew 4, verses 4, 7, and 10. I won't do those again. Look at Matthew 22, 37, 38. It should be very familiar to you. And he said to them when they asked him, what's the greatest commandment? You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. This was his answer to their question, trying to trap him. And he went to a citation of Deuteronomy to give them their answer. Mark 7:10, for Moses said, honor your father and your mother, and whoever reviles father or mother must surely die. He cites this as their need to show proper respect toward those whom God has placed over them. And then again, Mark 10:19, you know the commandments. Do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not bear false witness, do not defraud. Honor your father and mother, citing from the law given to the new generation about to cross over. So it was a book acknowledged by Jesus to have Mosaic authorship, but also treasured by Jesus. And in it you see that prophet forecast who would teach the love of God to the people of God. That is, in a nutshell, the book of Deuteronomy. Any questions or comments? We're going, of course, next week, Lord willing, we're going to cross over next willing in Joshua and see Joshua get ready to lead the people over into the promised land. Questions or comments, observations that you have before we dismiss tonight?